Yeah, this is not my thing. I don't like getting in front of folks and talking. I guess that's at least one way I'm not like my father. And yeah, the only reason I'm here, this guy. He's talking about when he was in hospital. Yeah, he caught me on his deathbed and he extracted promises.
If you want something.
And then he went and lived. And the militant. I don't know if you remember. First time I ever met this guy, he punched me in the chest.
I wasn't gonna say that. Yeah.
You were hoping I'd forget.
Yeah, that was in Mexico, right?
Yeah, it was in Mexico. First, punched my punk ass in the chest. So yeah, militant. You know, I should preface this. I think it'll come through in what I'm about to say. But please, if there's anything, any part of what I say that you don't agree with or that bothers you, I welcome a conversation about that. Absolutely. And some of you have heard some of this, because it is in what I've posted on the Alternative Considerations of Jonestown website. And by the way, Jim, no reason for it to go in a book. You know where to find it now. Anybody can find it. And frankly, I just don't have enough to say, nor desire to be heard. I want to tell you about what it's been like to be with you folks in the last 40 years, and what it's like to be here with you now. But I need to begin by offering in contrast my perspective on life in the temple in Jonestown. Oh, so long ago. Much of which was pulled from something I wrote decades ago and is posted on the Alternative Considerations of Jonestown website. Please forgive me for speaking in general terms. I speak of us as a movement, if we were such a thing. As a community, and that we were for sure. There were, of course, many individual exceptions. We meant well. That I'm certain. Nearly all of us would rather have helped than done harm. To have made this world a much better place, and yet so many of us helped Dad and his circle do great harm. Either with a direct hand or by feeding the temple's unhealthy appetite in some other way. Or by looking the other way when someone else did these things. And man, did we know how to play. Laughter was our favorite thing, with song and dance a close second. We were in great need of its relief, its release. The gloom and doom can really weigh on you after a while. All that us against the world shit. And our laughter could be pathetic and mean, but was far more often beautiful. It's a doorway to harmony, to oneness, to the Creator, when seemingly very different people find the same thing funny. We were not a good organization that turned bad, whatever those things are, to any individual, or a group that lost its way. We were ruled. From the very beginning, we were ruled, not led, ruled, subjugated and manipulated by a narcissistic, paranoid, bitter, disillusioned, delusional, and frequently ridiculous man, who was, as far as I can tell, pretty disturbed before he made it out of his childhood. Our good works were often a means to an end, and while most of the good people performing those good works were doing it from their hearts, the people directing those works were too often primarily aware of how it looked and who it would impress. I mean, come on. Our credo was the end justifies the means. Never, the way I see it, never has there been a more pernicious, a more toxic belief. I would argue that the means justifies the end, but never the other way around. From what I could see, nearly every kind of person joined and stayed for every kind of reason. We were a mixed and a mixed up bag. Compassionate, mean, passionate, depressed, courageous, cowardly, faithful, paranoid, vivacious, dull, and so many of us were heartbroken. And they taught me so much about soul and sacrifice. Listening to my father and living with my temple family, often largely against my will, instilled the values that I pray will guide me every day. I pray every day that they will guide me every day. This is necessary when you're as messy as I am. My words could never do justice to the beauty and power of black and white and yellow and red, every skin color imaginable, dressed in every other color imaginable, swaying and bumping and thumping to something got a hold of me gospel and a good dose of sooty and sensuous soul. All our barriers crumbled, our lines rubbed out. You forget who's who and who you are. We'd mix and melt and enter the music as it entered us. No past, no future, no thought stood a chance. Utter belonging. With some of the most lovely, remarkable people I've ever known. Oh my God, I had no idea how much I loved those people until I lost them. And that belonging, that sense of great purpose, it's hard to let it go when every inch of you screams at you to do so. We championed all the right causes, but it seems to me that we were more against than we were for anything. We hated hatred, and we were bigoted against bigots. We wanted to rule the rulers and torture the torturers. Everything and everyone but us was wrong, wrong, wrong. Again, of course, this is not how all of us felt or operated, but as a whole, this is how we felt to me, especially at the top. And there was a top in what was supposed to be an egalitarian society. I'm going to pause here for just a second and just explain something that I think is important. I had the benefit of seeing behind the curtain at an early age. Many people didn't have that. I had the benefit of having irrefutable evidence of my father's responsibility. No way to blame anybody else for what I saw happen. So, and I was also, as any good adolescent should, looking for reasons to drag him off the pedestal anyway, as my father. So, no great insight on my part, just a better angle to view these things. We talked about waiting out nuclear Armageddon so we could build our utopia. I remember thinking, when we dance on the ashes of the world we claim to love so much, maybe then we can stop talking about how fucked up it all is. Of course, Dad never revealed the secret of how he would make us all radiation free. We wanted to make others wrong rather than do what we felt was best for all of us, inside and outside the temple. Even when I resisted Dad, it was about making him wrong, about showing him how bad he was. It had little to do with me asking myself what was best for the greater good, or just for me, and standing up for it. It was just a battle of egos. In the temple, inspiration and insight was discouraged, dampened, punished. So far, I found that change, growth, evolution, revolution, is first and foremost, if not entirely, an inside job. In the temple, my insides felt crushed, not cultivated. If I desire or dislike something too much, if I place my happiness and peace on the absence or acquisition of anything remotely material, I can be hooked, played, and left on the bank gasping for air, wondering what the hell happened and who I can blame, other than myself, of course. As long as I hold myself separate from creation, from the Creator, I am capable of doing and allowing great harm. Dad tapped into something deep and truly genuine in himself when he worked people, when he showed them what they needed to see in order to get them to do and give him what he wanted. I also believe he largely did that unconsciously, It's all he ever knew. People saw the good works and looks of the temple and the seemingly genuine warmth, compassion, and eloquence of the man who seemed to be the force driving it all, and they spent the rest of their temple lives rationalizing and redirecting responsibility for the sickness that coated and snarled all of it. I think that, as a community, we simply lost sight of the one thing that could have saved us. Albert Einstein describes it well. The most beautiful and profound emotion we can experience is the sensation of the mystical. It is the sower of true science. He to whom the emotion is a stranger, who can no longer wonder and stand in rapt awe, is as good as dead. To know that what is impenetrable to us truly exists, manifesting itself in the highest wisdom and the most radiant beauty, which our dull faculties can comprehend only in their primitive forms. This knowledge, this feeling, is at the center of true religion, unquote. And I would, with great reverence, add true courage and compassion. I hurt people, directly and indirectly. I and a small group of men, white and black, humiliated and terrorized a man once on the orders of a man I despised, and whose approval and love meant more to me than I could ever have admitted. We lost control of the situation, and he fell into a shallow well, and shame, a toxic and worthless feeling that is entirely about what others think of me, drowned out compassion and guilt after we rescued that lovely man from ourselves, and nearly 1,000 people sat in the Jonestown Pavilion and did nothing. Most of them cheered and otherwise showed their approval, and many of them probably horrified and terrified while doing so. How am I capable of such evil? When I lose my soul in the image of me, when your view of me is more important to me than the eternal in me, when all connection is lost to that part of me which is of God, here's what I know. This belief that you and I are separate, that your pain is not my pain, that your misery is not my misery, that your joy and peace and bliss are not mine, it is a lie. Einstein called it an optical delusion of our consciousness. I believe this with all of my heart. Problem is, my mind and actions often don't align with this, and my amends for the inevitable harm that results must be painstaking and thorough. And it is between me and our Maker. And it all brings to mind the words of the mystic poet Rumi, as translated by Coleman Barks. Out beyond ideas of right doing and wrong doing, there's a field. I'll meet you there. So that is what our community has become. It is not at all what I believe we have become. That last bit from the magnificent Rumi, that level of being, that soul-fed, ego-free way, well, I've gotten glimpses of it with you, my brothers and sisters. Years ago, someone dear to me pointed out that home, for me, seems to be wherever I am, that I kind of carry it with me. This has been true since we lost so much that was so dear, and I topped it off with a few months in Guyanese prison. At first, it was a rootlessness, an inability, an unwillingness to connect in a world that is so transient, so impermanent, so damn unreliable. I'd like to think it's evolving to where I feel most rooted, most connected to creation through my being, my soul, that part which is permanent. The first survivors gathering I went to, I felt at home with a group of people for the first time in a long time, maybe ever. It was truly a reunion. Y'all were easy, and I was at ease with you. The cynicism I'd felt in and from the temple was replaced by hopefulness. Realistic, but hopeful. And the realism was held as a relative thing. We all knew that we had many different perspectives on many different things, and that was accepted, even embraced, frankly celebrated. I think it was relieving. Very relieving. And for the most part, this has continued. I have felt from you, my friends, something that I've come to believe, that there can be many different perspectives on something, and all of them can be correct in the moment they meet. I also believe that if we truly feel that way, if we want and try to fully understand other perspectives before, or God forbid, even instead of, trying to make others understand our own, if we're all that open and excited by our differences, if they truly are differences, we can conceive of, or even create, something none of us could conceive of on our own. And I felt like I have tilled that kind of rich soil when I have been with you. And we've seen eye to eye on a lot as well. And we just refuse to take any of it too seriously. So how do we feel to me? At times tentative, always forgiving, positive, playful, loving, and on the mend. I have something I say to my magnificent daughters, as often as they can stand it. The same way every time. I love you with all my heart, forever, no matter what. And God loves you more, but not much. Of course, I don't always feel this way, and I sure as heck don't always show it. But I know at my core it's absolutely true. And I pray that Asia Moon and Kaylee Nita and Jaden Rose know it's true too. I pray that they know that they saved my life. That without them busting into it, this tired and broken heart would have died a miserable death years ago. And without their absolute insistence that I keep my heart open, I would not have gained an inch on the path to wholeness and happiness. And although from a human perspective, I must reserve all my heart for God and those amazing women that I am blessed to call my daughters, from the deeper place in which I'd like to reside, the same goes for my temple family. Every one of you, gone, remaining, and new. And yeah, my healing and growth demands that I include Dad too.